Okay, well, we might as well go ahead and get started. Thanks for coming, everyone. Welcome. Do have some extra parking permits if any of you need those here. Thanks for joining us for this afternoon's Wheatland seminar. Most of you know who I am. Those of you that don't, Tony Gray with the Wheatland Lab here in the School of Forest Resources. And we're very excited to have Jarlath O'Neill done with us this afternoon. Jarlath is the director of the University of Vermont Spatial Analysis Laboratory, and he also holds a joint research scientist position with the U.S. Forest Service. His work focuses on extracting meaningful information from remotely sensed data to help managers make better decisions. Jarlath also leads the University of Vermont UAS team, which has carried out over 1,000 missions. In support of various transportation, natural resource, and disaster response projects over the past 6 years. In his prior life, Jarlath was with the United States Marine Corps for over 10 years. So let's welcome Jarlath.
Great, folks. Thanks for having me. When I agreed to do this, I thought I'm just traveling within New England. This would be super easy, but getting from Burlington, Vermont to Orono, Maine is the same amount of time as going from Burlington, Vermont to New York City. So, but it's through a good part of the country. So thanks, good to be here, and I enjoyed chatting with folks. So I'd like to sort of walk you through today some of the UAS work that we've done at the University of Vermont, and hopefully it's a way to, you know, share, maybe inspire you, or maybe you think, gosh, you know, the stuff that we're doing is so much better than those morons in that two states away in the Socialist Republic of Vermont. So either way, I hope you take something out of this. But a little bit background about myself here. You'll probably notice that I do have a little bit of a British accent. So I was born in the UK, but much like Arnold Schwarzenegger, I've lived here for so long that neither of us should have accents anymore, but we do. But because things like, you know, all the British TV, Downton Abbey's back in fashion, right? So it's cool to have a British accent. I've been working tremendously hard to get mine back as best as I can. So I am traditionally trained as a forester, although my skills from everything from dendrology to land navigation have degraded considerably since my time at UNH. But that's also where I got my start in remote sensing. So I took a wood science and technology course there, and half of the class was out doing cool stuff working in our sawmill. The other half was the boring part of identifying wood, or what I thought was boring. But the guy who taught it was a guy, Barry Rock, who was trained as a plant biologist. But what he said, you know, what I really do is I identify forests that have been subjected to acid fog and acid deposition using satellite imagery. This was back before Google Earth or any of that stuff. So this kind of like blew my mind at the time. And I got to work with Barry both in New England and even got to go over to Eastern Europe as an undergraduate, studying this kind of stuff, high elevation forest decline, which of course is horrible, but also very, very interesting using satellites. Also worked on some of the early projects using Landsat satellite imagery to map deforestation in the Amazon. I was just, you know, what we affectionately called to as a map monkey back then, and we only had 2 gigs of disk space to do all the mapping for the entire deforestation in the Amazon. And the computers crashed all the time, and we'd get to go out and play volleyball, so that seemed like a really good job. So this got me excited about being a GIS professional, because the quality of life seemed to be exceptionally high. Made a strategic decision and thought I was enrolling in the Peace Corps. Turned out I got the corps mixed up, and so I ended up in the Marine Corps after graduation. That was okay, because you get all these taxpayer-funded vacations to the beaches and other things like that, so it ended up being kind of enjoyable. And actually, my forestry skills came into play here, and a lot of credit to my Professor Dick Weirich, who taught our land navigation course at UNH, because, you know, the common thing is lieutenants who can't do land navigation, and my skills were really solid thanks to my forestry degree and a faculty member who really, really pushed us to do good land navigation. Came to UVM after my active duty time. And if you've seen that movie Office Space, there's a guy that they fire, but he never leaves, so he always has a job. It's kind of like me. I've been at UVM as a graduate student, a research staff member, and then a faculty member. And I've been in the spatial analysis lab the whole time, and one day I just found out I was running the thing. So it's proof that if you just stay put, you know, people always talk about to move on to opportunities, but sometimes if you just stay put, things just happen to you as well. So This is our group here at the Spatial Analysis Lab. We've got myself as a faculty member, and then we've got five full-time staff, and then we actually don't have, I don't supervise any graduate students. We do graduate students who come to the lab through other faculty, but I'm primarily focused on undergraduates, so 10 to maybe even close to 25 undergraduates at a given time, working on a part-time basis during the school year, and then full-time over the summer. Right now, we're managing 28 different projects. Some of those projects will last for 2 weeks, some of them will last for 3 years. We'll just depend on that. A lot of work with agencies like the Forest Service. We have traditional grants from folks like NASA, and then we also do a lot of work with the private sector where we actually do subcontracting type stuff. Just more about me, I'm a passionate winter bike commuter, so that's me there. We have Winter Bike Day in Burlington, and every year it's always magnificent conditions. This particular day it was -7 degrees. It's my friend Dr. Chris Stanford, professor of mathematics, and that's actually our chief of police, Brandon Del Pozio. So the nice thing about living in the People's Socialist Republic of Burlington is you get to engage in these fun activities. That's my family there, my wife Julie, who's an MD PhD, and my three children that fortunately inherited her genetics and are pretty cute as opposed to mine, so I'm very fortunate. We have some animals there. That's my daughter Maeve with biking around with her chicken in a pouch. This is our dog Yurik, who has various small friends depending on what we're doing. That's our bunny Caramel, and this is a small pig that we fostered now and then. You know, Yurik has no comprehension of how big he is and that he could actually eat these things, so he's actually a little bit afraid of both the bunny and the pig. The pig's no longer with us. I also play in Burlington's fourth most popular marathon rock band called Sciatica, which is, and I play lead cowbell. And we're, if you ever run the Burlington City Marathon, we're at mile 18 and we know three songs, and we only know the first 20 seconds of those three songs. It's Highway to Hell, No Sleep to Brooklyn, and Highway to Hell. And you may think, why do you only know 20 seconds? That's all you need. You only see it for 20 seconds. So learn more than 20 seconds of those songs would be useless, unless you're in the 5 hour plus marathon finishing pace, in which case then you hear the first 20 seconds about three times. But as long as you're pushing 3:30 or better, you'll just get those 20 seconds and it'll sound pretty good at mile 18. So anyway, I do a lot of high resolution land cover mapping, especially related to forestry and urban forestry applications. But a number of years ago, we got nailed with Tropical Storm Irene in Vermont. Originally, this was supposed to be Superstorm Sandy, supposed to slam into New York City and cause a tremendous amount of damage. It didn't, so as soon as it missed New York City, everyone forgot about it, but it sort of centered itself over Vermont and dumped in some areas. The estimates were about a foot of rain overnight. And you know, we're a state with high topographic relief. Our hydrologic networks and our transportation networks are very, very closely linked. So this caused tremendous amount of damage, hundreds of millions of dollars to our state. And, you know, it was all this kind of stuff, road washout. So we had good friends whose commute to drop off their kids at daycare went from 7 minutes to an hour and 20 minutes for over a year. So that gives you an impact. And that's just because one culvert in one stream that was normally running at about a few inches that time of year turned into a raging river of about 8 feet, and it was just went down, just blowing out stuff left and right. So real, real impact on the state. And, you know, one of the things that really dismayed me, and especially given my time in the military, was how difficult it was to get actual information from remotely sensed data at the time for this particular operation. So what happens in natural disasters like this is there's something called the International Charter, and basically all the countries that own satellites, and even many of the commercial providers of satellite imagery, will agree to turn on their sensors, and everyone agrees to share data. But by the time you get your collection deck, which is probably wrong in the first place because you don't necessarily know where the damage is, off to the people who cue the satellites, you're looking at about a 72-hour turnaround, which is way, way too short if you're trying to figure out the damage to your state, or way, way too long. It takes too long for us to get our hands on the data and then disseminate it and extract it, and all of that stuff. And by the way, Vermont is the cloudiest state in the union, so much of the data that we had coming in from the satellites was cloud covered. So when we think about all the things we needed in disaster response, getting the right location, making measurements, accuracy, spatial resolution, currentness, and being able to deliver to decision makers, satellites weren't really meeting any of these criteria. And this was a time where drone technology had really was on the forefront of our minds. You know, when I got pulled out of grad school over to the big sandbox for the stages of Iraqi freedom. You know, that was when we first started really using drones in earnest. So drone technology was out there. We're familiar with them, largely in a military context. But we also had the miniaturization of things, thanks to cell phones. Batteries were shrinking, cameras were shrinking, GPS was shrinking. And so we got to the point where, you know, commercial vendors started producing drones. And so in terms of, we had this disaster which really motivated us, and then we had this confluence of technology that allowed us to get into drones. So the other exciting thing that happened wasn't just the flying machines, but someone at University of Washington over a decade ago, this guy, Blazin Karya, had developed the technology that went into Microsoft Photosynth. And I don't know if any of you remember that, it's since been decommissioned, but he did this really cool project where he went out on the internet and found all these pictures of the Notre Dame Cathedral and built a 3D model from it, just from pictures people had taken. So if you think about, you know, my time in the military where we built 3D models using socket set, we'd have to find tie points between these photos. Suddenly that became automated. So we had these flying machines, and then we had the ability to take the data processed from these flying machines and turn it into ortho photo mosaics and 3D models. It was a really exciting time. So I was frantically calling around after Tropical Storm Irene to all these different funding agencies. NSF told me to go pound sand. They said they didn't think my ideas were warranted any funding at all, which isn't the first time they've said that, and I don't blame them. But we had a program manager at USDOT who fortunately thought this sounded really good. And I'm not a transportation engineer, but I suddenly claimed lots of expertise in transportation in order to get this funding. But this is what allowed us to start our drone program. And so I'm not sure if they gave us quite this amount of money, and it certainly wasn't in cash. But we're really lucky to not only get an initial round of funding, but a second round of funding then to implement UAS technology in the state. We're really, really grateful for them. And so we got into buying drones that we wanted to use for mapping. And so the first systems that we got were these things called the EV. This is a little commercial system. The reason why we went with commercial systems is because we're not aeronautical engineers. We're not tinkerers. We're not computer programmers. We are people that want to work with data. And so we were primarily focused on data, and that's what we wanted to get out of the systems. And so along with our transportation research center, you know, we spent about 82% of our grant coming up with a fancy logo, which any good company does when they start up. So we came up with that, which is a great logo. But what we really wanted to do straight away was get into disaster response to show our relevancy. And we had this, which was an Amtrak train derailment that happened in Northfield, Vermont. Fortunately, no one was seriously hurt in that case, but we were able to deploy within an hour, get out there, integrate with the Vermont State Police. So we integrate with the Vermont State Police, their vehicle there, and actually capture imagery of the train derailment. It's not the first time a drone had ever been used to study a transportation incident on a rail line. So that got us in the press, which was pretty nice. And it got us ahead of, I think, of a lot of the negative drone media in the state, which is really, really helpful when it came to people wanting to impose regulations and things like that. We had some feel-good stories early on, which was really important. And then we started doing a lot of work in which I'd say, because we had this DOT money, anything that was related to transportation, we would just tell people to say, hey, call us up, you've got some weird idea. It's kind of like throwing spaghetti on the wall. We would just throw stuff up and see if it stuck. And so we flew hundreds of missions, the majority of which actually went nowhere, and we realized that UAS was giving nothing but a pretty picture. But a lot of cases, the things actually became useful. And one of our earliest use cases early on was thinking back to Irene, where you had a situation like this, right? If we look at a road and we look at the 3D model and the stream washes out there, what the state overspent on is figuring out how much fill gets needed to repair this road. They didn't have enough surveyors to go out and survey these accurately. And in many cases, they couldn't even reach those locations because you've got a portion of the road that's out, and then further on there's another portion out, and then further on there's another portion out. So UAS technology proved to be really advantageous here because not only could we get orthophoto mosaics out of drones, but we could build 3D models within a matter of hours. And then we found out that we could go in and do some volumetric estimates and actually get within 5% of the volume that you'd get by scanning with a ground-based LiDAR system and do that in a fraction of the time much more quickly and certainly much, much more efficiently. So we've been using these things for 7 years now, and you know what I really like about these autonomous systems is that my video game skills go back to Nintendo days where it's up, down, left, right, A, B, and so a lot of these systems nowadays fly autonomously, which is really great if you're a middle-aged person and you don't play a lot of Xbox. I do try now to hire a lot of young folks who have spent a considerable amount of time in their life doing video games, but the fact that we can just go out and program a flight path and launch these things up in the air is really, really compelling. So I've just got some videos here that if you're not familiar with drone technology, really how easy it is. But here we are, we've got even an elevation model built in this particular case in the flight plan. So we've said this is the area that we want to map, and it does the calculations. We specify things like maximum operating altitude. That little circle that you see there is the geofence, so it won't fly outside of it. And here it is sped up going ahead and executing its mission. You can see it's capturing all the photos there. And then it'll just do its thing, and if everything works well, we'll come back in and do a little landing, and then we just take the data and we process it. So it's the same thing we've always done with aerial mapping. It's just a lot easier, and we actually have the systems that fit in a suitcase now as opposed to requiring manned aircraft. So, key things about launching your drone is that we do grade all launches on a scale of 1 to 10, and what really gets you the high points is your leg kick. So you notice in this case that really nice 90-degree angle there, and a nice straight back leading up to my head. So my head is a little bit tilted back there. So this is really a 9.8. If I wanted a 10, we'd want to see a straight line there. So just some pro tips about drone operation there. We've got a little video here that one of our students who came from a design background put together just to give me an idea about how these things work in flight operation. So there's the drone just getting assembled, throwing in the camera, throwing in the battery. You know, there's really nothing that's too fancy about these drones. They're just miniature aircraft and everything's just been shrunken down a bit. But there you just chuck it up in the air and then it's doing its thing. As soon as you throw it up, if you're fans of Terminator and Skynet, you know, it's self-aware. Don't say mean things about it. It's a flying machine. It will come down. You even do have drones. This was shot before we found out that this is technically against FAA regulations. We can actually have two drones. It'll even the software will deconflict them in the air. Gavin made the video, so he did this slow motion here to make himself look really cool. I'm not sure how long he was out there shooting that video. But here's two drones actually doing a mission in tandem. And then when they're flying in the air, what's great is that you're just monitoring them. And as long as everything's going well, you're just getting the location on your little digital map on your screen. And then they come in and do a little crash landing, what we see there. So a lot of you are probably familiar with the multi-rotor operations, and you may own one, or your kids may own one. But for mapping perspectives, these fixed wing systems are really nice. It's just a very expensive flying piece of styrofoam there. The technology behind this, and of course, is really the digital photogrammetry. So here's an area that we've flown. Each one of those red dots there represents a location for which we've acquired a photo. And the key thing has been digital photogrammetry that just allows us, honestly, to feed all these photos into a software package, press a button. There's even cloud-based services now that you don't have to know anything about photogrammetry, and you can actually get some pretty decent ortho photos out of them just by pressing a button and uploading things. And so for any given location on the ground, we're flying with pretty high overlap, sometimes 60, maybe even 80% overlap to generate a 3D model. So we may have dozens of photos contributing to a single location. So here's an example of a project that we did in which we've been flying a stream corridor for woody debris monitoring. This requires multiple flights over the course of a morning, about 3 to 4 hours of total work. But here we're using a digital photogrammetric software package, clicking on the ground there, and so you can see all the photos that are contributing information to that particular location. And so in terms of how we fly, probably not the most efficient because we're acquiring so much overlap for a given location, but this is really necessary in high-resolution digital photogrammetry in order to get the good 3D models that you need to remove distortion and all that kind of stuff. We're just so excited that there's smart people in mathematics and computer science that figure out all this stuff so we can just press buttons and analyze data. And so we can get out, everything from digital ortho mosaics to 3D point clouds that, in some cases, can be even better than LIDAR under the correct conditions. And so I'd like to walk you through some of the data examples here. This is not an oblique photo. This is a 3D point cloud that we use for a community planning project. Here's just that swiveled around and shot from another location. So the point cloud here is colorized. But you're going to notice here, if you look under the trees there, right, we've got data gaps, okay? And we've even got some cases here where we're seeing through the canopy because the 3D model failed there. So it's not the same as LIDAR. We're not getting canopy penetration in this case. We're getting only surfaces for those areas where we actually have not only what the imagery can see, but where we can find the matching points between them. So we also do infrastructure inspections using some of our multi-rotor drones. This drone is like a butterfly on steroids. It's pretty big. The camera is located right in the front here, and this will swivel so we can get under a structure and look up, or we can fly over a structure and look down. It's got hypersonic sensors, so you know how close you are. You notice here it's got carbon buffers around the propellers here, so if we get too close to a structure, we bump this instead of bumping the propeller, in which case it's going to fall into the river. Not that this is the thing that stopped us from putting these in the river, since we've done that anyway, but you know, they try to minimize those types of things. Flying these drones is incredibly difficult, so we'll show you. Oops. Let me go back. I'll show you a little example of one of these in action. A really, really tricky mission. This was a windy day. We're inspecting a railroad bridge in this case, which is about, it's over 100 years old, like much of our aging infrastructure here. So this is the situation. We've got the railroad bridge there. It's a cold winter day. The state of Vermont has one rail boom truck where they could actually get someone who might be able to see some of the underneath of the bridge, but they wouldn't be able to get in this far. You know, maybe you can put someone out on that frozen stream in a kayak, or they're an undergraduate student, just a dry suit and a life vest will do fine because they're a little bit more expendable. But you know, with drones, we can get in there, and this is where the technology starts, right? Dangerous, dirty, and difficult situations. And it's easy to think that in this case, oh yeah, you know, drones are superior technology. A lot of things around infrastructure inspection do require people to get their hands on it. Sometimes they have to tap things and listen, and the drones can't do that as yet. So oftentimes they're a technology that is very useful as a screening tool or a complementary tool, as opposed to a replacement tool in this case. These drones have pretty advanced things. Like in this case, we're doing, you can fix the distance from the bridge, and it'll just travel horizontally to it, taking pictures for building your 3D models and things like that. And so in this case, you can see we threw a circular pattern over the bridge, and this is how we built a 3D model. So in this particular instance, we've got any location on the ground, probably 20 to 30 photos contributing to that. Okay, so about a 10-minute flight in order to produce this type of data, but pretty valuable. The downside of this is if you're a bridge inspector, and they've been working on this bridge for 100 of years now, and they've got the records going back 100 years, each one is a sheet of paper, and then we show up with our drone, and we suddenly dump 7 gigs of data on a bridge inspector's desk, 2 gigabits of which are this fancy point cloud, and this guy has no idea what a point cloud is, and we've given them over 280 photos. We're not helping them. We've tied them up for 4 days of trying to figure out what this is, and then they don't even know who their GIS support is with their organization, who they go to figure out how to load a point cloud. So one of the things I'll mention at the end is how disruptive this technology can be in an organization. We try to think like, oh, we understand this stuff. We're helping you. And when you see the resistance to implementing this technology, it doesn't matter if it's forestry or bridge inspection, whatever it is, it's often because people lack the tools to make effective use of the technology quickly and effectively. And so if they can't carve out time in their organization to learn how to use the products, this is just making their life more difficult over time. So we've got a lot to do still on that front. Just some high-res pictures there. If any of you are Predator fans, the greatest movie ever made by Arnold Schwarzenegger, which is two people that became governor, both Arnold Schwarzenegger and Jesse the Body Ventura, and then one of the other guys actually became a state senator. That's just a headway into saying that this isn't just a thermal camera mounted on that. This is completely uninteresting thermal imagery here, but those sensors are integrated as well into that drone. So we do a lot of flood mapping, and that's sort of why we got started. And so our ability to go out and not just capture data about the flood, because it's not like we don't know this road is flooded, the DOT truck is right there blocking traffic. But if we want to redesign our infrastructure in this case in order to accommodate higher floods due to climate change or other issues, UAS technology provides that type of information. In this particular case, this is the river, and we've got an ice jam downstream here, so everything is backed up. You can see this here again. This is the riparian buffer. This is an agricultural field, so in this case, we had floodwaters going a quarter mile that way, and then there were some homes out there that had to be evacuated. So U.S. technology is really useful. One of the most important things we discovered when we were doing disaster response is not being good flying drones. That was really easy, but we were kind of showing up in our standard Vermont garb, which is Birkenstocks and Ben and Jerry's tie-dye t-shirts. And if you've, I don't know if anyone here is in a volunteer firefighter, but you know, my friends, I started doing volunteer firefighting. Like, and there's two reasons why we do this. One, we want to get out of the house. Two, we want to have cool gear. And so we show up to these disasters, you know, just dressed like that with our safety vests, and people are like, who the heck do you think you are? So we invested a lot of money in thinking about how do we look as cool and professional. So we've got patches with our drone logo on. And the other thing is, don't show up to a disaster if you don't have an American flag on your sleeve. But wait, there's more, because then we thought, well, what if we screw up with the drone? We don't want people to know who we are. And we thought, well, who is to deal with that? Special operations people, right, in Iraq and Afghanistan, they've always got those Velcro patches with their logos, because you just strip it off and then you're like, I'm just a 6'4" blonde-haired American just on vacation here in Afghanistan and camouflage, you know, I'm not part of any military unit. It's really deceptive. So we bought the Under Armour tactical assault shirts there. So we rip those patches off, we replace this with Canadian flag, and the Montreal Hiking Club logo goes right there. So whenever something bad happens, that's our way out. It's incredibly incredibly effective. But this is just an example here. Sorry, going back there. We're still not going back. Well, we'll give up going back. But in that particular case, we're in the emergency operations center there because we're in the emergency operations center here because we do all this cool stuff, kind of like the bridge inspection. Vermont does not have anyone in emergency management who is dedicated to GIS. So you can collect all these ortho photos and cool stuff like that, cannot do anything with it. We've done disaster response exercises with FEMA, where we went out and we went to the emergency operations center. They had us fly all these missions, generate 3D models. We show up at the satellite emergency operations center. How are they tracking things? A map on the wall with push pins. I admire their backup plan because the power goes out, they're really functional, but they're also not operating the modern information age. So once again, the tricky stuff isn't flying the drones, right? It's the organizational barriers to implementing the technology. This is a neat project we did down in a town called Barrie in Central Vermont near our state capital, Montpelier. This is Gunner's Brook here, like a lot of streams. We thought the good thing to do back in the early 1900s was to wall those in. Of course, the stream has a mind of its own, and you can see here during floods what happened here. Now, do we know that these homes were impacted by the flood? Absolutely. We don't need a drone to tell us that. But increasingly, FEMA is looking for verifiable information when it comes to a disaster if you want to get reimbursed quickly. And so drone technology is very, very effective, because not only can we generate digital ortho photos, it can be overlaid on top of other geospatial data and have coordinates, we can map stuff. We can bring in the property parcels. We can highlight those property parcels that were affected. We can then return the addresses and owner information from those, right? So verifiable and actual information that makes it easy for people to get reimbursement from the state or federal government in a more timely fashion. And that's where drone data is coming. This is what they call a wrong way bridge in Vermont here, periodically floods. And the nice thing about drones here really is that temporal resolution. Here we are flying with a color infrared camera. So you can see us there. March 20th, ice is on the river. April 9th, ice is melted. We go to April 16th, we're under flood conditions, right? And so we can fly at just the right amount of time to capture peak flood conditions. Once again, if we want to think about re-engineering our transportation infrastructure, now we have verifiable information to do that. We spend a lot of our time, and I was mentioning this last night, early on when we got into drones, because some of the stuff that we're doing crosses into sort of traditional survey type mapping activities. And I thought the surveyors would be really threatened by us and not want to work with us. And it turns out just the opposite. They're really busy and they'd like to find their jobs easier. And not to bash surveyors, but if you ever go to a survey conference, this is, and they have a map contest, every single map looks like this. I'm not the world's best cartographer, but I'm certainly better than this. And what's really nice about integrating UAS technology with, in this case, contours from a traditional survey, is that if you were to go ahead and just bring in like the state ortho photos, in this particular case, the area of interest that they're redesigning this road for is right here. So there's a severe amount of erosion. They've got to take this road here and they've got to shift it over. That's why they're doing the survey in the first place. Just so happens that when the imagery was acquired for the state ortho photo program, that particular area fell within shadow. So we can just go out there for 20 minutes with our drones, acquire this, and because you've got these things like onboard RTK technology nowadays, we can get, even without setting up ground control, sometimes 1 to 3 centimeter horizontal accuracy, which kind of blows my mind still thinking about it. In this case, you can see how well our imagery overlays with the contours. And I think this is a nice way of showing how you can integrate UAS data whether it's imagery or surface models with traditional techniques. And then it also saves time, where in this particular instance, you know, when we go back to redo this, the surveyors really only need to get good data for this location here, right? This is where the important construction is happening. The contours for all these other cases, we can just derive that from drones, right? It's not absolutely as crucial that we spend days for a surveyor doing, laying out all that work. This is with Evan Fitzgerald doing a stream restoration project. This is the data that we had captured with a drone. Keep in mind these conifers here, that's gonna be important in a little bit. This was an area where we didn't have LIDAR in Vermont. So this is the USGS 10 meter resolution elevation data for it. And this is our surface model derived from the UAS data. Not LIDAR, this is just photogrammetry. So the important thing here is one, hey, check out the cool stuff that we can see in the stream. But two, check out this area of this weird triangulation where we don't have any data. If you recall, that's where those pine trees were, right? So we have to keep in mind a lot of capabilities, but also a lot of limitations. And so this will lend some of you to say, well, why don't you just put LIDAR on those things? Well, that little styrofoam plane that we have in that particular case weighs less than 2 pounds fully loaded. As soon as we want to put a LIDAR sensor on a drone, well, LIDAR sensors are heavier, so we need a bigger drone. Okay, if that drone falls out of the sky, worse things will happen than a flying piece of styrofoam. We also have to power that LIDAR sensor, which means we have to throw another battery on the drone, because now we need a battery to power the drone and a battery to power the LIDAR sensor. So now we even need a bigger drone, okay? And then the LIDAR sensor is shrunk, so it's actually not even that powerful. So you don't always get the same type of canopy penetration that you would using a much larger LIDAR sensor. And this is true for all sensors. The thermal sensors that we have on drones, we've done dam studies where they're really interested in having us find leaks in the dam using our thermal sensors. We thought, yeah, no problem, we'll just get our drones out there. This is not the same type of FLIR pod that you get on a Black Hawk helicopter when the National Guard does search and rescue, right? These are these giant round things. These are highly miniaturized, and the resolution wasn't good enough in that case. We have to keep in mind that when we shrink things, you know, smaller, it's kind of like Snickers fun size. There's only fun size about a small Snickers. You want a real size Snickers, right? When you shrink these thermal sensors or you shrink these LIDAR sensors, they're oftentimes just not effective. This is a long-term monitoring project that we did in Plainfield, Vermont, the Great Brook there. They've got periodic flooding and damage to this bridge. So not only did we do before and after images of just the bridge itself, but we flew about 3 miles of stream. And the reason why we did that is they needed to come up with a woody debris budget, because once you know the movement of woody debris, then the engineers could do the calculations to figure out the size of the bridge they would need to accommodate that debris during these storms. So this was, I think, a case where UAS really shined. Like, you think about doing woody debris inventories in the stream. There was a guy, George Springsteen, who's a professor at Norwich University, who would try to do them through field work. There's a lot of erosion here. Not only was it taking George a lot of time, but one day he actually was on a slope and there's so much erosion, he fell down the slope and broke his leg. And it's Vermont, so it's kind of like Maine, like we don't have a lot of cell reception. So he sat out there for 3 hours. And in his case, you know, his wife noticed he was missing, and so she was able to go out and look for him, and they found him and he was okay. It was my case, you know, it may have been 3 or 4 days before my wife thought to think of me, and so I'd still be out there. But it's a real good example of where doing the field work was actually dangerous. Satellites lack the resolution. Traditional aerial mapping would not have been cost effective for the town in this case. So we were able to go out and fly monthly for them. And then when the storm actually happened, in which that a few inches of rain happened overnight, we were able to look at the before and then after images and then do some comparisons. And this is from a few years ago, where we still fly for them on a somewhat regular basis. And it's really amazing what you see here, right? So pre-storm, post-storm, this is kind of a weird, freakish summer storm, highly localized. Take a look at the woody debris here, right? That's gone. Take a look at the new erosion on the slope here. And then just take a look here about some of the rocks in the stream, right? This thing's big enough that it stayed, but take a look at its little friend there. This is something new that showed up. We can also see that the channel has shifted. The type of detail that we get with 2 centimeter resolution imagery and the types of things that we can see are really amazing. And it's not to say that we shouldn't do field work anymore, but I think we're getting to the point where, you know, years ago we started saying, well, you're going to the field, might as well bring a GPS. We're probably getting to the point where it's like, you're going to the field, well, might as well bring a drone to get some aerial imagery while you're there, right? So that you can pack that stuff up. I'll show you just some of the point clouds we've produced for this particular area, which are really kind of interesting. So here's just a little fly through. If anyone gets motion sickness, I didn't make this as smooth as I could have. But here we are zooming into a location there and showing you the types of measurements that we can make. Once again, not LIDAR data, but in some cases can function somewhat similarly in terms of cross-section profiles and all that type of stuff. There we go. But anyway, this is kind of what we came up with. Here we have that stream. The bridge is right about there. And then for what we did is just through old school undergraduate mat monkeys, giving them Red Bull and Cheetos and telling them you're not leaving until the work gets done, but having them look at every single ortho photo collection and tag a piece of woody debris is still there, present, absent, or new, right? And so for that, we could cut the stream up into different sections here and then look at debris lost and debris gained, which was pretty powerful because for the locals, they're like, we just got like 10 pieces of woody debris that show up at our bridge. But then you actually look at the whole system and it's like, no, you have dozens and dozens, in some cases, hundreds of pieces of woody debris moving through that system. Maybe a dozen get caught at your bridge, but you need to have a new bridge designed to accommodate this influx of woody debris on a regular basis. It was also pretty powerful in that case because you could even see there was a logging operation. You could just see all the sediment that came out into the stream and onto a road. This is some aquatic invasive species mapping we've done out in Tahoe. A WorldView 2 satellite imagery. Wonderful satellite, very, very high resolution. The problem is you don't get to toss the satellites based on wave conditions. So here, what you see in Lake Tahoe, little white caps out there, okay, and waves, not ideal for mapping aquatic invasive species, especially when they're on the bottom of the lake. You know, you go out and fly a drone there, right, and you can clearly time it perfectly early in the morning where there's no waves on Tahoe and see all those aquatic invasives there. This is some more stuff out there. Wetland mapping, this is their existing ortho photo base imagery, very, very nice stuff. When we go out and we acquire it with a drone at the right time of the season, you know, once again, you're going out to do a wetland inventory, why not bring a drone with you? And if you want, you know, capture with color infrared or whatever you want. Another example here, WorldView 2 imagery. It's great. It's captured a particular time, but maybe the storm and you want to take a look at sediment transport in your stream, right? You time it just right and you can do all that with your drone. Aquatic invasive species mapping. Here we are looking at water chestnuts within Vermont. They clog our waterways. We spend an awful lot of money trying to remove them. And we can get the timing before and after they do the removal. And here we are flying with some fancy multispectral sensor. And it's true that the water chestnuts do really pop out here, but you know, we don't have any problem identifying them from the RGB imagery. So a lot of the things that we used to do in remote sensing and making use of additional wavelengths, those are really important when we had 30 meter pixels or we weren't imaging something on a regular basis. High spatial resolution imagery and high temporal resolution imagery, or just flying at the right time, can overcome a lot of limitations. So what we found with drones, and one of the key things I encourage people to think about when they get into drones, is focus on the strength of the platform. And the strength of the platform is the high spatial resolution and the temporal flexibility that you have. And there's a lot of things that you can do related to invasive species mapping and looking at when they green up or when species senesce that you cannot do with satellites or other types of mapping to give you insight into what might actually be there. More disaster stuff that we did here after the fact. So they wanted to do a buyout of these homes here with severe erosion. FEMA requires you to have a contour map, and so the town couldn't convince the surveyor to go out and do one in this particular stream. So we teamed up with them and did a 20-minute drone flight. This is the aerial imagery of that particular location. When we were out there, actually pieces of the slope were dropping off into the stream. And then here's the 3D model that we built. So 20 minutes of flying, you know, 2 hours of computer processing, and then 10 minutes of contour generation and screen captures to fulfill the needs of the bureaucracy. So a good use there, example of cross-section profiles. This was 10 caterpillar outbreak stuff that we had in Vermont. This is existing leaf on nape imagery that a lot of you probably use. And here we are flying with a drone. And if you look closely here, you'll notice some distortions, right? So all the nice techniques that we have for automated processing, when we get to areas where they look uniform or they're highly textured like the forest, we can run into issues. So the data generation doesn't always go as smoothly as we may have hoped. This is our obligatory reenactment of a Top Gun photo here. So here's our drone team out doing an airport mapping project. In Vermont, we had this big scandal with this whole E-1B visa for money things that generated a lot of headlines. We didn't have a lot happening in Vermont, so this was about as exciting as it got. But one of the things is they had this idea they were going to get these rich people to pay for green cards, and then they were going to come to Vermont. So we needed to expand the runways of one of our state airports. And so this is the state airport. This is it post-construction. As soon as you lengthen a runway, you need to make sure that your obstructions in the case of Vermont, your trees are not within the approach surface, right? Because generally planes and trees don't interact very well during takeoff and landing. Typically it requires a survey crew 3 to 5 days out there inventorying the woods. And so by teaming up with them and using a combination of drones and traditional on the ground surveying techniques, we went out, built a 3D model. You can see here, this is the point cloud. Here's some elevation profiling. We then went ahead and we extracted all the trees, little icons there extruded by height. And then this little cyan block that you see there is the approach surface. And we put it into a web app that we thought was super cool, but it turns out the FAA doesn't care about web apps. They just want someone to sign off and say, yes, the approach surface is clear. So good example of a lot of work for nothing, but I hope you appreciate the screen capture from that web app that we spent hours developing. So can you show that? There's a repeat. This is must be greatest hits there. This is mapping UMass Amherst campus. So I put this in here because UMass got $5 million from the state for their drone program, but somehow they only paid us $5,000 to map their campus. So it seemed entirely unfair to me. But anyway, here's, we did some campus mapping here. And then, you know, you can do all this stuff really, really easily. The thing that took the most time and costed the most was they wanted some features extruded in some buildings, right? So this took some poor undergraduate student who we didn't pay enough money, like 2 hours to do, right? So it's still, you know, it's just remotely sensed data. And in the end, you've got to exploit it, and the exploiting can take a lot of time and take a lot of care. This is kind of a sad and funny story at the same time. So this is an area along the waterfront that's Lake Champlain there, and they've been redoing it and putting in a new bike park. This building here is the site of a former power plant. And so it turned out that after they dug up the ground to put the bike path in, that the soil was contaminated, and they didn't realize that, so they put it in a parking lot in Burlington. If you've ever been to Burlington, Vermont, and you went out and bought food, you realize that you cannot buy anything that's either not organic or not GMO-free. So you can imagine the populace of Burlington when you find out the contaminated soil is sitting in a parking lot. I mean, people are just up in arms, right? You know, they ride in the street. So the city just asked us to come out and just develop a 3D model so that they could know the volume estimate. So this really took us 10 minutes of flying time, 30 minutes of processing, 2 minutes of analysis to give them a volume estimate so that they could just get a do an RFP to essentially cart the soil off to a site that could handle contaminated soil. So we got some repeated slides in there. This is another one that we do. We have a biomass facility that provides power to the city. So wood chips, twice a year, they're required to independently audit their wood piles. So we go over and we just fly the drone and do a 30-minute hike and then do the volumetric calculations for them. So, you know, a nice way of just drones making stuff more efficient and effective with the wood piles there. And here in this case, just competing with bureaucracy, but we get to go out and fly drones. This is an example of us doing a covered bridge inspection there and generating a 3D model from it. And this is, in this case, it was done just in case there's ever a bad flood and it takes out that bridge. With a 20-minute drone flight, we're able to build a 3D model so that if someone wanted to rebuild the bridge back to its original standards, they would at least have some idea of what it was like. This is an example of a rock slope study we did with New Hampshire DOT here. Looking at more efficient ways to analyze these areas that are susceptible to falling on the roads here. And this is a 3D model actually just done with a $1,000, what you call a prosumer quadcopter. Some of you may have these, the DJI fans, and they're fed into the fancy software there. Let's take a look here. Oh yeah, Torrey Hall, this is a Stark building on campus. We had a fire. And so afterwards we went into the drone and just, you know, you can build these 3D models, and this is an example of something you can just go up online. There's a 3D site, Sketchfab, or people who build 3D things, mostly like these anime characters. But you can just upload your stuff for free and make it interactive. So this nice new world we've had has made it much easier to share and distribute and interact with the type of technology. Another example there, 3D bridge, where we did the same thing. They required 3D models for some historic preservation, which kind of struck me as funny since this bridge doesn't look very historic or worth preserving to me, but someone in the bureaucracy thought differently. So we were happy to oblige them and do that type stuff. This is an example of a virtual reality. This is an app called Hangar here. Let me see, is it moving around? Yeah, so what you can do is you can launch your drone up and it can fly for about 5 minutes. It doesn't fly, it goes straight up about 200 feet and then it just spins around capturing photos for 5 minutes. And this is just virtual reality. So this can be in your phone or your website. but it's a real great way. Like if you have a study site that you go to, imagine you can just go out with your drone, press a button, it goes up in the air, flies for 5 minutes, and then produces virtual reality. So if you need to go back to that site and be like, yeah, what were the conditions like when I was there? Now you've got a digital record of it, which is pretty impressive. The challenge in this case is it's an app run by a company, and sometimes their servers go down and all those types of things, but it does give you some neat advantages. We've done traffic studies for people, really boring stuff like shooting video here. This is actually the 95 border with New Hampshire and Maine. They had an incident where they shut down one of the lanes on the bridges, and this was just done because the people in DOT wanted to know. People are calling up saying, I was stuck in traffic for 3 hours, and it turns out felt like 3 hours because you were with your wife and kids and dog, but it's really only 15 minutes and we can track your vehicle as it goes through there, so, which doesn't make people happy. We've done crash scene reconstruction with the state police. Massachusetts is really invested in this technology. If you're in Massachusetts in 93 and they have to shut down the interstate, I think it's $320,000 an hour is what they calculate. I'm not sure who the economist was that did that, but it sounds like an impressive number. But the reason is, if there's any fatalities, they've got to seal that off, and it's a crime scene. So if you can use drones to build a 3D model and reconstruct it, that becomes accessible. This is a neat project. Our team was actually just out this morning doing the 32nd flight of this. This is a construction monitoring project in Brandon, Vermont. So this is the ortho photos that go up on a web app here. This is for construction compliance monitoring. So every 2 weeks during the construction season, we go out and we fly. And so we fly in the morning, and then in the afternoon, it goes up on a web app. Everything's being flown, no ground control even anymore, just with RTK onboard GPS. And so for the compliance people, where they used to wander around for clipboards, now they're just using drone data. Really useful, these things where there's lawsuits or questions about environmental compliance and those types of things, having a digital record there. And we've done other things, getting out with the Civil Air Patrol, doing search and rescue operations. It turns out that where they're really useful for search and rescue is if the drone can locate, in this case, we had a downed plane simulation. The drone can not only locate it, but then they can hover over the location. And rather than transmit coordinates to the people, if you just hover there, people can hear the drone. And so they can run to it really, really quickly. So it's one of the interesting things that we learn there. We also do workshops and things like that, trying to share our knowledge with the community. And I think one of the interesting things that's come out of having our program in natural resources is that people come into drones from an applied perspective. They're not fascinated with drones, they're fascinated with doing something useful with drones, right? This may be different, no offense to anyone who's from engineering, but engineering perspective, but we're really interested in building the drones. And it's also led to a lot of improved gender parity within our group. So nationwide, we've got 95% of drone pilots are men, and with UVM among our 8 pilots, we've got a mix of 4 men and 4 women, which I think is you know, it's just putting out there that if you can approach the technology from a slightly different perspective, you get to have other people. And, you know, we talk a lot about diversity and its value. I'll tell you, when we go up and we knock on someone's door and we've got a mix of different people, and especially if they're young and they've got their UVM t-shirts on, they're much more likely to let us fly up their front lawn than, you know, if a bunch of people that, you know, are old and hairy and look like me, you know. So I stay in the car and send the young students out there to talk to the homeowners. But, you know, when we talk about drones, and I mentioned this a few times, you know, the biggest issues we see right now are not the technology. The drones will fly themselves. The computer software will do all the cool stuff. The analysis is very similar to what we've done all along. And as we try to implement this technology in government organizations, what we see are things where people are threatened by jobs. The organizational structure is such, they're not set up for drones. Drones are flying machines. So if you're a state, you say, well, that goes to aeronautics, which is my Department of Transportation, right? And they should control things. Those are the people whose sole mission is safety. They don't care about data. They don't care about analytics. They're a safety organization. So now you have an organization whose mission is safety, controlling something that maybe should fall under, you know, the data or the IT department. Personal feelings about drones. We've had things where we've gone out to meet with state agencies with someone higher up who may be very, very intelligent, but just doesn't like drones from something that they've seen on television or saw on the front page of CNN, right? When the drone hits the aircraft, that makes CNN headlines. But it turns out 2 weeks later that it was actually a plastic bag that's buried away somewhere. You know, the regulatory environment is still not to the extent where we're embracing the technology, all these things like the online of sight, we're not allowed to do at this point, despite the fact that the drone technology can usually accommodate that. You know, when you think about your investments in drones, you know, it's really good that, you know, folks like us and for folks here, that drones are based with your spatial analysis folks, because they are the people that already have the IT infrastructure. But for a lot of organizations, they think, oh, we just need like a few thousand dollars to buy drones. You know, it's very, very easy to accumulate gigabytes upon gigabytes of data within a single day. And then that leads to terabytes and terabytes. And then if you're a public agency, then you've got to think about record keeping and metadata and public dissemination. And suddenly your volume of imagery, which has to be searchable, discoverable, and everything like that, ends up costing you massive amounts of money. So when you think about these things like the payback period on new technology, because it's disruptive to the organization, early on implementing these drone technologies, which sound really good and sound really promising, but kind of like the $15 million financial system that we implemented at UVM. To some vice president, that sounded awesome. You know, it took Jarlath 4 years to figure out how to use it before I could actually tell how much money was left in my NASA budget, right? So I had 4 years where I didn't know what I was doing, and so I could just tell the dean, sorry, you can bail me out of this, right? But anyway, I'm probably talked for far too long, but certainly happy to entertain any questions that you folks may have, and I won't be sad if you just need to leave right away, because I have time for a lot longer than I should have.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you find that the beyond line of sight rule is a really big problem for you?
No, it's not in most cases, and that's because we prefer not to operate beyond line of sight, just from a feel-good perspective, because the drones are expensive. I think if I had a lot more money, then it would impact me. But we're still running into issues with lithium ion batteries where our drones cannot fly for too long. And so if the batteries were better and we could fly for longer, then beyond line of sight would really impact us. Because if we had a drone that could fly for 4 hours, we would just say, go map the screen corridor and then come and land when you're done, right? So the fact is right now, we generally have to leapfrog anyway because we're gonna have to replace the battery.
Can you talk a little bit about the functionality of the fixed wing versus the rotor?
Yeah, you know, we often get calls like, I've got this much money, what one drone should I buy? And a good rule someone told me is drones should come in packs of three. There's the drone that you crash, the drone that doesn't work when you're on site, and then the drone that you fly, right? So drones in packs of three is one important thing. And then it's just looking at what the use is, right? So the quadcopter that we have, if you go under the bridge with the gimbal, that's really great for infrastructure inspection. It's horrible for mapping the screen. It's slow, expensive, it's heavy, it's more risk prone. But you know, the quadcopters can do vertical takeoff and landing. So if you're in a very tiny opening, right, our fixed wing system, right, you're not going to be able to launch it. And sure as heck, you're not going to be able to land that thing in that system. And you don't want to have to clear cut a forest just so you can have your drone do a takeoff and landing, right? So the fixed wing system, you're really nice. They're light, they're very efficient. Telling these guys last night that we had a battery fall out of one and it will just glide to the ground. And the kinetic force that it has, if it hits you, you're going to be annoyed, but you're probably not going to need to go to the hospital. You know, even some of these small drones, one of those falling from 200 or 300 feet is going to injure you, if not potentially kill you. But generally, you want to have a suite of drones, and then you want drones that handle different sensors, right? And so this is why it's very, very easy to run into hundreds of thousands. So if you look at the cost of implementing drones in state agencies, I think a good example is Montana, $900,000 for their agency of transportation. And then you can tack on personnel training costs, IT costs, right? Our biggest cost right now isn't drones, it's the storage. We've got 50 terabytes of dedicated online storage, and then we need tape backup and fireproof vaults, blah, 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 right? So all this stuff that is not related to drones at all, that ends up costing a lot of money.
Any other questions for Jarlath?
Quick one question coming on the software side. The comment is, I didn't like that you said that in front of all these students. Just because you push buttons and don't need to know anything about photogrammetry doesn't mean you shouldn't pay attention to class.
No, and it's very true. It's very true though, but one of the things I forgot to add to that is it's become so easy to generate ortho photos that anyone can do it. And quite often we get pulled into projects where, you know, Bob got a DJI Phantom for Christmas and now he's hung a shingle on his door and he's 1-800 drone guys, and then the local quarry asks him to do change detection mapping, and Yeah, they're great. The drone will fly itself. It'll do a mapping mission. You can upload it to the cloud. There's cloud-based services that do volume differencing for you. But what Bob doesn't understand is his GPS has probably got 1 to 3 meter horizontal accuracy. So now his data is slightly shifted. And so then all of a sudden, he's showing volumetric changes that aren't there, right? So very quickly, you go from something that's potentially very easy in some cases to without having the appropriate knowledge of accuracy standards and photogrammetry, you land yourself in a lot of problems. And these are the issues that we see, you know, like we're talking with police agencies right now, focus on the 3D modeling aspect, right? And it's great, you know, you don't need a lot of training to get up and launch your drone and build a 3D model of a crash scene. If you want to start to make precise measurements about that crash scene, you better understand the collection of reference data, right, and how those reference data change based on different lighting conditions and all these types of factors that can really hurt you if you end up in court with those data. So thanks for correcting my means to service there.
Thanks. Did you say we can fly an RTK without a correction station?
So yeah, so we do have a base station, but quite often we'll just pump it through the cores network. And we've done, you know, it still doesn't, you know, because I'm not a surveyor, so I'm still like, I can't believe that our accuracy is actually as good as it is sometimes. But the only reason you ever would know that you're accurate is if you put in ground control, right? So you can read the software vendors, and quite often what we'll find is our horizontal is spot on, and our vertical is very, very good relatively, but our absolute is not accurate. And we often find there's about a meter vertical shift in our data. And the only way we will know that is if we have a surveyor go out and actually put in reference control. The other benefit is we've gone out and done a project with surveyors where we found errors in their data. So where we've gone out and checked the stuff and something went wrong there. And so I think this is the advantage of, you know, rather than turning it into what the drone industry wants to be with, you know, disruptive technology and all this and that, is think about how can we couple traditional surveying with drone aerial surveying to make ourselves more efficient and also check each other rather than trying to sort of, you know, outdo each other or saying that one's necessarily better than the other. They have capabilities and limitations, and we should be aware of those. Until you get out and do enough of these projects, you don't really appreciate all the things that can go wrong. You know, like shadows and things like that, lighting conditions can really influence our accuracy. When we went out for Red Bull and flew one of their mountain bike courses that they have, I thought they were just like this energy drink company, but they're like a digital media company. So we would fly the course on 3 different days under all sorts of different lighting conditions and captured massive amounts of data so that we could build a 3D model that had absolutely no dead spots in it. So that's an example where on paper it was a 20-minute flight. In reality, it was 4 hours of flying under different lighting conditions based on, you know, fortunately some good pilots that had some experience doing that. Yeah.
Why was Montana $900,000? I can't imagine it.
Yeah, so when you start to think about all the aspects of your drone program's costs, so all the drones you're going to want to buy and all the sensors, right, that's going to put you well into the 6 figures right there. You got a bunch of fancy drones, excuse me, with gimbals and all of that, and then suddenly all of your people need to take time off to do Part 107s. You might need to do a new hire to run your UAS program, and then suddenly IT gets involved and they say, well, we need to have all of your data. It needs to be backup and discoverable. So then you need to carve out a portion of someone's time who's doing that. Then someone else says, under our Digital Records Act, you have to store all metadata of your drone flights, right? I mean, you've just created a new massive bureaucracy within your state government, right? And you've got to figure out how to pay for all these things. But I tell state agencies, like really, you want to think about the low floor for starting a robust UAS program is probably $300,000, but more like $500,000, I think, is a pretty good estimate of when you look holistically at your costs or something like that. And a lot of times we're not set up for this stuff, right? So state agencies often have consolidated GIS people to sort of the headquarters level, and they fall under IT. Where do the decisions and actions happen with drone? Out on the edge of your organization, right? So we saw this in Vermont, where they've pulled all the GIS people from the state agencies into central IT. But now it's actually out on the edge, thanks to a lot of these technologies. That's where you need your GIS people. You need them working with your bridge inspector. And so now the bridge inspector has to work his request up through higher headquarters, all the way get down to get a GIS person who's already way too busy to get back to assist him for the bridge inspection so he can view a 3D point cloud, right? So it's organizationally, we're not set up for doing geospatial technologies and using new technologies at the edge of the organization. I think that's one of the major barriers there, which is why it's good to do it in academia. I mean, you just buy a drone and then 4 months later, risk management says you shouldn't be flying without permission. You just say, sorry, you know, they're never going to be a tenure. No one's going to send you to jail or anything, right? So you're in the clear. Life's really good. You do that in a state agency, you're not in trouble.
Any other questions for John? All right, thanks for joining us. Thank you, Jarlath. We're going to reconvene at the chat room in Orono, probably in another 30 minutes or so. So please join us for that if you can. Thanks again, Jarlath.